What is up, guys? How's everyone doing? Welcome back to my channel. Today, me and Isan, we drove all the way out from New York to Poconos and Kalahari Resort to see our brother Zarrukh Adashev and to train with him, to spend a day with him, how he spends his cardio day. Today is his cardio day. Today is Saturday. And I could say I got my ass kicked. What's up, Zarrukh? How's it going?
What's up, everyone? Today's supposed to be my conditioning strength training. Mm-hmm. I wasn't in New York, so I came with my family to have some time in Kalahari, right? Mm-hmm. So to skip this training, it would be bad.
Yeah.
Yeah, I have my coach, conditioning strength coach in Jersey, the Bulldog gym. I should have to go this morning, but I couldn't go, so I did conditioning today here. Like, I was running, I was doing pads with my brother in New York, Murad.
Yeah.
And thanks, guys, for coming and filming me.
Yeah, no problem. We got our ass kicked, by the way.
Yeah. He was training good too.
Yeah, I was
trying his best.
I was trying. So yesterday I flew out from Chicago. As you know, I moved out to the Midwest and whatnot. And I came like around like 2 o'clock was my flight. And then I'm here for only 4 days. And I was like, hey, Zarrukh's around the town. I always wanted to see him, make a video with him, and train with him, obviously, you know. And since I just began to do fitness, it was like a great thing for me. And especially yesterday, I walked all the way from Upper East Side to Lower Financial District in Manhattan. But it's not about me today, the podcast. It's about you. People would want to know more about you. Obviously, we're making this content in English, even though Zarrukh is from my hometown, Samarkand, from Uzbekistan.
We can speak Uzbek, Tajik.
We can speak like four languages if you just give us that. But we want to inspire kids who are in the States, who are chasing their dreams. Yeah. It doesn't matter what it is. It could be fitness, it could be art, it could be creative stuff, it could be business, and just in general, someone who's striving for greatness. Because since I've known Zarrukh from 2017, I remember, like, I think great minds think alike. When I saw you training all the time, I was like, that was the time I started to film. And I was like, you know what, I have to like reach out to you, you know, like, let's make a video. And if you remember, your fight was in Chinatown, yeah. Manhattan.
That was kickboxing belt.
That was a kickboxing belt. And I was like, so inspired to create content all the time that I was inspired by your fight too. I was like, goddamn, I have to record this. And that's why I reached out during that time in 2017, I remember. 2017?
That was 2017 or 2016? 17?
Okay, beginning of 17.
Oh, yeah.
Because I remember in that vlog, I made a vlog from that.
I remember that.
I said Trump was just elected. So the day you were fighting was the day Trump got elected in the States. Okay. So I still remember that because I made a vlog about it. Let's start from the beginning. When did you start training? How old were you? And who put you into like these like martial arts, you know?
You know, I started training when I was 5 years old in my back home, Samarkand, Uzbekistan. Mm-hmm. I started there. I started from hand-to-hand combat.
It's called hand-to-hand combat?
It's called hand-to-hand combat. It looks like mixed martial arts, actually. Mm-hmm. But it's one round, 5 minutes. Mm-hmm. And you can do kick, you can do boxing, you can do grappling, you know? Mm-hmm. But MMA is obviously it's 3 rounds, mm-hmm. and it's in the cage. But hand to hand combat is not in the cage, and they score every your kick and punches by mm-hmm. the point. So it looks like MMA. You can do grappling, striking, everything.
Okay. And how long did you do that for?
I started when I was 5. I mean, since this is when I came to US.
Yeah.
Since it's 18, I was 18 when I came to US. You know.
I see. I was talking to my dad the other day because he put me in like a training facility too. So it started with like Taekwondo, ITF. And I was like, why did everyone back home put their kids into like training? You know, like people from our country or like more to the east, like even south of Russia, Uzbekistan, Kazakhstan. A lot of people put their kids into like fighting combat sports, you know?
It's really popular in Uzbekistan, I'll be honest with you.
Yeah.
Like, for example, in the US, they play basketball, football, you know? They do everything, but in our country, it's more like fighting style is more popular than other things.
Yeah. So my dad's answer was like, I put you in combat sport is because to get into the university, it'll be much easier for you to get in if you're an athlete.
Yeah.
You know, so yeah. They make an exception even like in East, like if you are a combat sports and if you have a reputation in fighting, yeah, and they will accept you more easily into universities to obviously it works the same thing in America.
And also
too.
To defend yourself in school. In back home, yeah. Every day I used to fight in the street, you know?
That's true.
Every day you coming to school, like, you see bully guy, you have to fight him, you know?
Exactly.
He says, like, yeah, you want to fight me? Yeah, let's go.
Exactly.
Every day. I used to fight every day. Every day.
Yeah. So one of the things I remember from back home, I studied until fourth grade. We used to do, like, you know, every class, like, they had to find out, like, who was the better fighter.
Yes, yes. Who is the...
Chef. They used to call
chef,
the chef.
Yes. Who is the boss of the class?
Who's the boss of the class?
Yeah, I was boss of my, like...
Your grade?
Yeah, my grade. Like, I was fourth grade, right?
Yeah.
I was, like, boss of the fourth grade.
So you used to beat everyone?
Until ninth grade, yeah. I was school boss, you know? I was boss in my school, yeah.
I see. But... the school ends after ninth grade over there, right?
Yeah.
Back in Uzbekistan.
School ends, then college.
And then college, and then university.
Yeah.
It works differently, obviously, from countries to countries. But what happened after that? Hand-to-hand combat, you did that, and then
you did
sambo?
Yeah, I did hand-to-hand combat, but I used to go to tournaments to combat sambo. It looks like same, you know? It's
okay.
Similar, like hand-to-hand combat sambo. It's
okay.
Similar sports.
I see.
And I mix it up everything. Like, in amateur, I can say I won every competition. Like,
in Uzbekistan?
In Uzbekistan, when I came to US, I did like 1 year amateur fighting.
Okay.
Kickboxing.
Uh-huh.
In Uzbekistan, I won many, many times Uzbekistan championships, Samarkand championships, like city championships.
So, what are the titles that you're proud of in Uzbekistan?
I won Asian championships.
Asian championships?
In 2010, I won Asian championships.
2001?
2010.
Yeah, okay.
I was adult already.
Okay.
Then I won... международный турнир
чемпионства. Worldwide?
No, not worldwide.
International?
International championships.
Okay.
Actually, I was number one in my weight, 60 kilogram.
Okay.
I was number one. Every time, like, I was winning, like, Uzbekistan championships.
I see.
Mean, I was in
Asian
top three, you know?
Okay,
Uzbekistan.
The Asian competition was in kickboxing, right?
No, hand-to-hand combat.
Hand-to-hand combat.
Then when I moved to U.S.
Also, when you moved to U.S., you started doing kickboxing.
Yes, I started doing kickboxing. In kickboxing, I won 2 times world championships here.
Okay.
In MMA, I got second place.
Mm-hmm.
2012
mm-hmm.
World Championships,
because mm-hmm.
I fought in 75 kilogram. My weight was 60 kilogram.
I see.
You know why I fought 75 kilogram? Because there is nobody was in 60 kilograms.
Oh, so you had to gain weight.
Lower weight was 75. I didn't know that when we came to Florida, that was happening in Florida, WEK World Championships.
Okay.
When we came to Florida, then next day they couldn't find me opponent because lower weight was 75 kilogram. They said, you're not going to fight. I said, how I'm not going to fight? They said,
so what was your weight when you fought?
60 kilogram.
60 kilogram?
I was 132.
You were 132?
Yeah, I was 132.
And you fought with a guy who was, what weight, 75 kilogram?
75 kilogram. He was...
And you kicked his ass?
30 pounds
heavier
than me. No, yeah. I won first fight.
Yeah.
I won, then... they moved me to final fight.
Damn.
They was interesting about me, you know? I was,
okay.
Like, small guy came up, first round knockout. I did knockout first round.
I see.
First fight.
That takes guts to, like, fight at a higher weight than yourself, you know?
Yeah.
Because I see, not to disrespect any UFC fighters, I see the some of the UFC fighters go the safe route. They only fight their with their own.
I
class,
know, but
you know?
Now I go same way. You know?
Now you go same
yeah,
way
because I'm professional now. That time I was like crazy. You know, yeah. Like I came from Uzbekistan. I was wild. I want to fight with anyone. You know.
Yeah. Like that energy was the same thing with Conor McGregor at his prime.
I was hangry, hungry. You know, when I came, like I was like. I came in July, in September was World Championships, right? I was like, I'm ready to fight with anyone, you know? They said, no, you can't fight. I said, how? I spent $500 to came to Florida.
To
they
Florida,
said,
yeah,
okay, money is not important, but your health is important. I said, no, I'm going to fight. They gave me the contract.
Yeah.
I signed it that I'm fighting, like, I want to fight on that weight.
Yeah.
If something will happen to you...
Uh-huh.
We're not gonna be
liable.
Yeah, liable, you know?
Yeah.
Then I fought. I get all the way to the final. And final, I lost, but the fight was crazy. You can watch it on YouTube. Daniel
really?
Chacon versus Zarrukh Adashev.
I'll check it out.
Check it out. The fight was three rounds. Beginning of the three round, he got armbar.
Who?
The guy. He did armbar to me. I tapped.
Okay.
I lost.
I see. So, that was kickboxing.
No, that was MMA.
That was MMA.
Then, 2013, I went to Greece. I won world championships in two division. I won in K1, then full contact. I did nine fights in 3 days. That was good experience, you know?
Nine fights in 3 days?
Yeah, nine fights in 3 days. Oof. But that was immature, you know?
That's ridiculous because I've done wrestling in high school too. And we used to go competitions, but nine fights in 3 days, that's pretty...
I used to do that the time in Uzbekistan.
Yeah.
Every month, like eight fights, seven fights. Now, that's why I have good experience.
I see.
I like it, you know?
Yeah, the way you told me how you fought like above your weight class, I remember Conor McGregor was like fighting Diaz brothers. I think they were above his weight class, right? During
I think
time?
So, yeah.
Like, that was the crazy stuff about Conor McGregor, because... I still am when I was a big Conor fan when he was coming up, because his energy was crazy.
Yeah.
People were feeding off from it. Well, such a cocky,
hungry, you know?
Such a cocky guy, and not also cocky, but he can defend his words too.
Yeah,
that was
a
time where he was like backing up his words. And the craziest stuff for me was when I was realizing I wasn't into UFC that much. My friends called me out to go to the bar. It was like, let's go watch this UFC fight. I go see this guy, and this guy's fighting with someone above the weight class than he is at a professional level. And I don't see much fighters
do that.
I'm not
going
to
fight in professional level.
I know. I want to ask, are there, like, I don't know that, but are there fighters that are fighting above their weight class right now in UFC?
Yeah, Cejudo. He used to fight in 125, Henry Cejudo.
Yeah.
Then he went to 135. He got that belt too, you know. Now he wants to fight 145.
No way.
Yeah, he's crazy too, you know.
He's good.
He's next level fighter.
Henry Cejudo.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And he's Olympic champion. Wrestling Olympic champion.
Yeah, I remember when I was in high school.
And he's also, now he's cocky. He wasn't like that.
Well, obviously, I think when a person achieves a greatness, right? Now they're like, I'm not gonna curse obviously my podcast, but hey, he tells everybody like, you guys don't believe in me, but look at me, I'm a two world double champ. He calls himself double champ, so he's
bend
a
the knee
champ.
He says always bend the knee
exactly
to triple C.
He has the right
and
he can be cocky, you know what I mean?
Of course,
he put in the work.
He's a legend.
When I was in high school, so with me, with combat sports, I've done combat sports too while growing up in Uzbekistan, but I didn't just follow up with it. So in Uzbekistan, I started the same age, 5 years old. 5 till 11 or 10 years old, I trained in Taekwondo for 2 years, and 3 or 4 years for, I think I did kickboxing in Uzbekistan. Right after coming to America, I stopped training. Because my parents were like, you got to learn English now. Go to school. Do this. And I started doing high school. While in high school, I started wrestling. Because all the Uzbeks, and plus I went to FDR, like in the heart of Brooklyn. Like the whole team was Uzbeks, basically, in the wrestling team. And we were looking up to Henry Cejudo, because I think he was the 2011 or 2010 championship. He won the wrestling. And I was looking up to him. And growing up, it's just like you see new champions like Jordan Burroughs and Jordan Burroughs became like the new legend in wrestling. But that was the whole story. But something I wanted to touch base upon, when you came to America, right? How old were you?
I was almost 19.
You were almost 19?
Yeah, almost.
You came here alone or with your parents?
I came here alone.
Okay.
I didn't know anything about US. I didn't speak English that time.
I see.
Only Russian, Uzbek, and Tajik. And also in 2012, now for example, you're coming to New York or Brooklyn.
Yeah.
A lot of Uzbek people, a lot of Tajik people, a lot of Russian people. That time, like, it was hard to find the Uzbek people, you know?
Yeah.
Now when you come, they're helping you, like, they're showing everything to you, you know?
Well,
like,
they
where you have to go,
what do you need to do, jobs?
Yeah, jobs, everything. That time was hard to find a job, you know?
Yeah.
Because I couldn't speak English, and I didn't know where I have to go.
So I have a question. When you came here, did you continue your training, like, right after, or did you start working and then started
back? Right away, like, next day, I found the gym, Lions Fight.
You arrived in America, and then the next day you went to the gym.
Yes, I went to the gym. The guys who I know, he found the gym for me, and I went to Lions Fight. Then I started, and I didn't stop after that. But before I came, I stopped training because the people keep saying me, like, if you go there, you can't train, you have to work, you know, you have to do that. You think you're tough, but the guys who's tougher than you, they go there and they can't do anything, you know? When I came, I was like, why not? I was dreaming all my life, you know? I was dreaming all my life. I was trying to come to US to fight here.
To fight here.
And I was trying to find the ways how to come. Then I won green card. Yeah. Then I came here. How I'm not gonna follow my dream, you know?
Exactly.
Then I said, like, this is mine, I have to go.
Yes,
then when I started, our people, like, when people tell you, what are you doing? Like, you know,
why are you training? Yes.
No, they will say, like, if you see someone, like, right? Yeah. You say, like, our people, like, assalamu alaikum, how are you? Everything good?
Yeah.
Like, what are you doing now for a living? For example, I'm doing that. And I'm also doing training, you know?
All right, so we're back. We got cut off with a memory card. So you were touching base upon, like, people telling you, like, what are you doing? Like
for living,
for
right?
For living, yeah. What do you,
That time I was working for a moving company, like a party rental company.
Mm-hmm.
I used to work with Uzbek people, you know? Like, they were saying, like, why are you training, you know?
What's the point?
What's the point to train? Like, I was telling them, like, I want to follow my dream, you know, I want to make money from that. They were like, they were laughing, you know, like, okay. They was like, there is a bunch of people better than you, and they stopped. I was like, okay, they better, but they stopped.
Exactly.
So I'll be better than them then.
Yeah.
They didn't want that like I wanted, you know?
Yeah, you didn't want it as much as you wanted it. Yeah. Yes.
Then I was keep following my dream, you know? And also the trainer, Artyom Sahakyan, Lions Fight owner, he was keep pushing me too, you know? I was about to move to Philadelphia to, I found the job there, like, to clean the floor of the market. I think
that
was
in 2013?
Yeah, no. 2012, sorry.
2012.
Then I was trying to move. Then he said, no, don't do that. Just follow your dreams. Don't listen to anyone, you know?
Like,
Artyom
said that to you?
Yeah, Artyom said that to me.
Yeah.
Then I was like, okay, I'll do that, you know? That was hard, but,
no,
you know?
Like, one thing I have to give it to you is you have surrounded yourself with great people.
Yeah.
Obviously, great trainer. Not everyone's going to think about you and talk and tell you something that will benefit you in the future.
Of course, yeah.
A lot of people, they look at something that you will get off of today.
Yeah.
Oh, how much you're making today? And you're like, don't worry about how much I'm making today. I'm thinking about how much I'm going to make in 5 years. That could be more than anything that I could even
and
make.
And also,
you know?
I wasn't thinking about the money.
Money,
you know?
Yeah.
I just love this.
Exactly.
And now I'm not thinking about the money.
Yeah, yeah.
I just love this. I'm doing this with love. You don't have to do it and think about the money. If you think about the money,
okay, I agree with the same thing. Like me and Ihsan is shooting like our podcast right now. Obviously, we don't always do these kinds of interviews, but when we get the chance, it's amazing to do these interviews with people, you know,
yeah.
People like you. These videos are going to live on the internet forever. And sometimes living is living. I do work when I have the time to shoot bar mitzvahs for Jewish people. I work with our people, do weddings, birthdays, you know, engagements. Those videos are going to be in their home, and they're probably never going to watch it. So I also don't do this for financial gain, you know what I mean? Because I love doing it. I began doing this because I love doing it. Do you know that I've quit accounting because I wanted to do this? I was in college.
Yeah, yeah.
It was my fourth year. I was about to graduate with accounting degree, wanted to become an accountant, but I was like, no, that's not the way I want to go. This is the way I want to go. I want to teach myself and do things that I actually love. And so what do you want to tell the kids that are like at home, they like their parents are telling them, hey, get a life, what are you doing, playing or like playing basketball or fighting, or
they just have to work hard and follow their dreams, you know, and don't give up, just go forward and do it. If you love it, just do it and follow your dreams.
I see. So do you think persistency is the key? So you have to like keep doing
it. One day you're going to reach there. One day you're going to reach there. Just work hard and nonstop.
Yeah. So I believe in this theory. There are no wins without losses.
Of course.
You know?
Yeah.
You can never win without losing. You know? Yep. Losing is actually getting you closer to winning.
Yes.
You know? So obviously a lot, like this was your first fight with UFC, and I was amazed, to be honest, because you were the first from Samarkand, Uzbekistan, to get into UFC. I know there is like another person who made it to UFC, yeah, but I don't think he's actually from Uzbekistan.
He is from Uzbekistan.
He's from Uzbekistan?
He's from Bukhara.
Oh, really?
Yeah, he's from Uzbekistan. He was the first UFC fighter from Uzbekistan.
Yeah.
But not from Samarkand.
Yeah. And you were the first one from Samarkand.
Yes.
So that was amazing to me. And then when people started saying, like, Zarrukh made it to UFC, I was like, I knew it. 2017, like, great minds think alike. Like, people feel the energy.
Yeah.
You know? I felt the energy back then, and that's the guts that I have. I don't know, like, if it's given from God. Like, you become closer to people who you know that they're going to get there someday. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I believe in that guts. And yet, 3 years later, here you're in the UFC. You had your first fight in UFC. It was a loss, but I don't think it was actually a loss. It was one step closer to your win in the next
this
one.
This is what
hopefully.
It is, you know, like, the guy who won the Tyson name, he deserves the win because he was.
How many fights did he have, by the way? I hadn't seen his record.
He has like 32 professional fights. MMA
in UFC. What about
no,
in UFC?
No. In UFC, that was his third fight.
That was his third fight. He had two losses.
Two losses, yes, in a row.
Yeah.
But the third one he won.
Okay.
But the guys deserve it, you know?
Yeah,
he was working hard.
Yeah.
All like camp, all his camp was like 6-5 months.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not going to be fair if I'm going to come out like in 2 days and won the guy, you know? But I was ready to win, you know? My mind was like working like, I'm going to win this fight. I'm going to take that bonus, you know? I'm going to knock him out. But my body couldn't walk. Like in 2 days, I cut like 25 pounds.
Can I tell the viewers, just to recapture, if you guys don't know what happened between Zarrukh's fight? So Tyson Nam, he had an opponent that he was fighting with, but the guy withdrew. Something happened to the guy, right?
Yeah.
He got sick? What happened?
I don't know what happened.
So somebody forfeit the fight, and UFC needed an immediate fight with for Tyson Nam, and they needed a contestant, and that contestant was Zarrukh Adashev. So they contacted him while he was on vacation, basically during quarantine, while everything was closed. The gym was closed,
in New York.
Barely training, and then he got a notice, 7-day notice you had?
No, five days notice. They called me like Tuesday night.
Yeah.
So Friday, I have to make, wait, 2 days, like.
2 days.
Wednesday, Thursday. I have Wednesday, Thursday to cut weight.
Okay. So he had 2 days to cut weight.
Fight third one.
And fight on the third day with a person who has been training for this fight for 3 months.
I mean, it's not excuse. It's excuse, you know?
No, it's no. It's a huge thing because a lot of people would say, like, a lot of people have a question like, oh, so if you knew that he was training for 3 months and you've only trained for like 3 days, why would you take the fight? I know how it feels, actually. Because when you are like actually getting a contract from a fighting company like UFC that you have dreamt for.
And banging them to get me to the fight, you know, 8 months.
Yeah.
Then I was waiting. Then quarantine started. I couldn't training. You know, especially New York was crazy.
New York is still closed.
Everything was closed. Everyone was scary. You know, then I stopped training, and it looks like you coming to someone's door to get into their house, like you knocking the door, like they're opening the door. They said coming in, and you turning around and you going. You know, it looks like same. I'm knocking the door, UFC, like, give me a fight. And they welcoming me, then I'm going to say no. How it's going to look like, you know?
Of course, yeah. They will say,
no, next time, you're not going to fight.
Exactly.
That's why if I'm fighting, I'm putting everything I have. If you go there, the Warriors have to be ready to die in that cage, you know?
I'm
one of them. If I go there, I'm just going to fight. I'm not going to cancel the fight, like... Of course, if I get injured, I'm going to cancel it because you can't fight while being injured, crazy, you know?
Yeah.
But if you go to that cage, you should have to put everything you have. Like, you should have to be ready to die in that cage, you know?
I see.
The Warriors should have to be like that.
So, touching base on, basically... If you keep asking someone to give an opportunity, and you get that opportunity, you turn down the opportunity, you look bad. Obviously, first, number one, and plus second, you dream of being in UFC since you're like 5 years old, and then the opportunity comes when you're like in your 20s. How are you gonna say no? How are you gonna say no? Here's a contract. Take the contract, and I don't need the fight. Yeah. Who's going to say that? You got to be dumb to say that, obviously.
And also, you know, like, before I was dreaming to fight in UFC, like, then when I went to US, I was dreaming to be world champion in amateurs, you know?
Amateurs.
And then when I won world championships, then I was like, okay, I'm not world, I'm world champion.
You're a world champion. World champion. In amateurs.
Now I have different, like, goal, you know?
Yeah.
Then... I went to pro, then in kickboxing, my dream was to fight in Glory kickboxing.
Mm-hmm.
Then I went to Glory kickboxing. Then I was dreaming to be their number one Glory kickboxer, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Obviously, they didn't have my weight, but they gave me five fights in Glory. I won all of them. I was training hard. And then I was thinking, like, I have to go to... MMA, you know, I was dreaming to be in UFC. Then I went to Bellator right away.
Yeah,
the Bellator and Bellator is also like one of famous and top MMA promotions. And I was like first Bellator fighter from Uzbekistan too.
I see.
I'll be honest with you. And then I fought there. Then they don't have my weight too, but Bellator 125 they don't have. Yeah. Then I was dreaming to be in UFC. You know, like. Uh-huh. Now I'm in UFC, but I just don't, I want to be there. Mm-hmm. I want to keep, if, God forbid, if I'm going to lose my second fight or third one, like, they're going to cut me.
So how many, you only have two chances with UFC?
No, I mean, they give me four fights.
Four fights already.
I don't want to be there, like, my MMA record is like new, right?
Yeah.
3-1.
Yeah.
I don't want to be like 3-4 record.
Yeah,
in
yeah.
UFC, everyone will make fun of me, you know?
Exactly.
Now, that's why I'm training hard. I want to win that fight. I want to be in UFC. Like, I want to get into it.
Yeah.
Then I'm not going to be there only like a UFC fighter. I want to be in the top. I want to get that belt, you know? Yeah. I have big goals. I have big goals. That's why I'm training hard. I'm trying my best. When I get there, I'm going to put up everything I have.
Okay, I see. So, what would you say your style of fighting is?
I mean, I can say I'm a mixed martial artist. Your
wrestling is not bad, and you're also on the feet too at the same time.
I'm striker. You know, I like to strike people, but most of the people they think like I'm typically striker. You know, typical striker.
I see.
But I can do wrestling.
Yeah.
And I proved in my MMA. Bellator fight.
Yeah.
I fought with the wrestler and jiu-jitsu guy, black belt jiu-jitsu.
Yeah.
I did good, and I was trying to do choke to him, armbar. But I'll show my skills. When I get there, I'll show my skills.
Skills. So someone like, a lot of people look at Khabib, right? Yeah. He's the guy who's been wrestling bears since he was a kid.
Yeah.
And now he's wrestling human beings. Obviously, wrestling human beings is much easier than wrestling bears. I would say like wrestling is so like important in like MMA or like UFC is because like when I see Khabib and then plus when I see double champ, what was his name? Henry Cejudo. Yeah, he's also a wrestler. And these top guys are like mostly are wrestlers.
They're not just wrestler, they're mixed martial artists. I'm telling you, like, you think Khabib's striking is bad? He's good striker. I'm telling you,
he's a good striker.
His striking is good. Why not?
His strength is like on the floor.
Yeah,
like flooring the people.
But mine is more striker.
You're more striker.
I'm more striker. I like to strike people, but my wrestling is not bad too. You know, that's why I wanna. I'm saying that.
I see. The fight between Justin Gaethje, and then what was the other guy? The recent fight he had.
Tony Ferguson.
Yeah, Tony Ferguson and Gaethje. Honestly, I thought Tony Ferguson would beat the hell out of Gaethje because I thought like he was good at like in Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu, you know. And what ended up happening was like Gaethje just beat him on the floor, like just like as a boxer. It looked like it was a boxing
also,
match.
Also, if you knew that the Ferguson did 2 times weight cut, did you know that?
No,
because he's supposed to fight Khabib like before Gaethje, right?
Yes,
he did weight. Uh-huh. No one told him to make weight.
Yeah.
He just did weight.
He still did the weight. Yeah,
he did weight. He said, "I made weight." You know.
I remember that was.
Then
after two
weeks, he have a game fight coming up. He did again weight, you know? It's hard to do that.
Yeah. He was fighting at 155?
Yeah, he was fighting 155. In 2 weeks, he did 2 times weight cut. It's something crazy, you know?
Yeah,
when I do weight cut, like after my fight, I'm gaining like 20, 25 pounds back.
Really?
Yeah.
As soon as possible?
Yes.
And wow!
Cut again, it's something crazy. That's why maybe
he had no energy.
He had no energy. Bad. He was like, he wasn't look good.
Okay, so obviously the fight is coming up with Khabib and Justin Gaethje, right?
Yeah.
So what are your predictions for this fight?
Khabib. Yeah, Khabib will maul him.
He's gonna maul him. Yeah, that's the only thing. I know Gaethje. He's really good at like punching and stuff.
Yeah, Khabib is smart fighter.
Oh my God, Khabib is in the next level. Like he doesn't like he's at the top level with human beings. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
Khabib has never lost.
So smart fighter.
Yeah.
He can't be like just fighter.
But do you think Khabib's gonna like? He's gonna be affected by his father's. Death. Recently, his father
maybe,
died.
Yeah, maybe, but Khabib is a mentally strong guy. He's so strong mentally. He's smart. I mean, he's inspiring me. You know, when I watch him,
okay,
like He motivates me, I'm telling you.
He motivates you?
Yeah, yeah. He's a really strong human being, you know?
So does he train mostly for his fights? Does he train mostly in the U.S. or does he go back to Dagestan?
I don't really know. I think every time he used to train in the U.S. But
because you train with Zabit a lot, right?
Zabit. Yeah, I train with Zabit. And
so with Zabit, like, how does it work? Does he live like on the East Coast in the U.S.?
Yeah,
does
he
train?
Before fights, he comes here like in 2 months.
Before 2 months?
Before 2 months, he trains here. He says it's comfortable for him to train here, you know. He's away from his family.
He's not distracted.
Yeah, he's not distracted, you know. In New York, like, for example, I live here, right?
Mm-hmm.
I do training camp here, and sometimes I have to go with my family somewhere. Like,
It takes energy from you, yeah.
That's why they come here. They doing training here.
I see. So, all right. I guess, yeah, I mean, that's how I realized too. A lot of the times when you want to focus on one thing, you have to focus on that thing, like, by eliminating all the distracting factors in your life. And sometimes it could be family.
Yeah.
Like for me, especially.
And sometimes friends too, they calling you like, let's go to eat something like plov, shashlik. Yeah, shashlik, you know, like, yeah. You go, okay.
Last time I came to New York, honestly, I think my friends are going to watch this. Last time I came to New York, there was not a day I was at home. Every day I was outside. And it's usually the same type of restaurants and same kind of food.
Yeah.
And then you gain all that weight and then you don't know where to lose
now it. Now I have like only one day cheat day. Like
one cheat
Saturdays,
day.
Okay. I can eat Uzbek.
So what's your favorite food?
Plov. Plov. Obviously plov.
Okay. So this won't be like sponsored video, but where do you eat the plov from? Which restaurant would you recommend?
In Brooklyn?
In Brooklyn, yeah.
Sherdor.
Sherdor, right?
Yeah. Sherdor is the best plov they have.
Yeah, yeah. I usually go there too. But it's been a while since I haven't ate plov, but hopefully tomorrow or maybe the day after we can go together. So, anything you want to cover?
No. And guys, sorry about my English if it was bad. And thanks to Parviz to come here to filming me.
Yeah.
Thank you to
Isan,
and thanks to my brother Murad to helping me to do pads, to my training. He's always comes when in my training camp. He's him and my brother. My brother is always with me like 24 hours before my fight. I want to thank them. You know, like they're my really close people to me. And thank you guys for coming and filming me.
No problem. All right, guys. So if you guys have enjoyed this content with me and Zarrukh, don't forget to subscribe, like, and share. I will see you guys in the next podcast. This was the first one. So let's see what kind of guests we can get more on these podcasts.
And see you guys before my fight, right?
Yeah.
Before November 14th.
Before November 14th,
we'll
try to make a content with Zarrukh. One goal that I have still is to go see you fight in person.
For sure, bro.
All right, guys. I'll see you guys later. Subscribe to my vlog channel. Is that a vlog channel? Docu channel. And plus podcast. I'll see you guys around. Bye.